Hi everybody, today I'm working on a 2003 Mini Cooper S. This car needs a head gasket. And the main reason we know it needs a head gasket is we can see coolant and water mixing here. It was consuming coolant and overheating. So a head gasket job is actually not all that bad as long as the head is not warped. Basically we'll remove the intercooler, we'll take the valve cover off, we'll take the engine mount off. On this side of the engine we'll remove the airbox, all of the thermostats and wires connecting to the head from this side. We'll pull the exhaust manifold bolts and then the intake manifold as well. And there's one bolt that's back behind this intercooler horn, and you cannot pull the intake manifold away without pulling the supercharger by the standard method, but I'll show you a little trick where you can actually get it to come off without having to remove the supercharger. So at minimum, to do this job, you're going to need a head gasket, like this one right here. I'll put a link in the description where you can get this stuff. You're also going to need a head bolt kit. These are torque to yield bolts, so it's not recommended to reuse them. I also have a valve cover gasket here, because this car is fairly high mile and it probably needs a new one. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. All right, the first thing I'll do is get under here and drain the oil, because we got oil and water mixed together. If you're just replacing the head gasket for another reason, you might not need to do it. This is a 13 millimeter plug, and I recommend using a 6-point socket because it rounds off pretty easily, and a lot of people tend to over tighten them. And this one's being stubborn. Somebody really over tightened this. Yeah, it looks like it's rounded off already, so I guess I'm going to need to go buy a drain plug as well. So I'm going to go get my Easy Out tool to get this off. Here we go. It's an Irwin bolt grip set. These work really well. You just kind of hammer it on. So you find the one that fits the best. Tap, tap. Okay, and go get my breaker bar. There it goes. Okay, yeah, we got chocolate milk in here. Another thing that typically happens is the fill level will be a lot higher because the water has been mixing with the oil. So sometimes you'll get like 5 or 6 quart of fluid coming out of the bottom. So if you have a smaller size drain pan, be ready just in case. Also, when you start the engine back up after repairing, be sure to run it with some cheap oil once or twice, just to circulate it through and get it all out of there. All right, while we're waiting for the oil to finish draining, we'll start disassembling the top here. The intercooler is held on by a Torx T30 fastener. Got one bolt missing here. Take the cover off. And then again, Torx T30 for the boots here. You want to be careful not to drop any bolts. To remove the intercooler, we need to loosen these brackets. I just do this and put them out of the way. Then we just pull backward. And it comes right out. Okay, next we need to remove these intercooler brackets. There's 2 bolts holding this one on, 8 millimeter, and there's 3 bolts holding this one on. So you'll need an extender bar most likely. Preferably one that's got a wobble end to it. Just unclip here and it comes right out. That's what the bolts look like from the back side. All right, next you'll want to pull back the fuel supply line here. You just pull on this plastic piece backward, it should come off. If the car has been driven recently, some fuel is probably gonna squirt out, so I'll just throw a towel here to catch it. I'll just kind of push forward to get tension off of the plastic bit here, and then I'll pull the plastic bit backward and then allow it to pop off just like that. So This car hasn't been driven in about a day, so only a little bit of fuel came out. Okay, next there's two 13 millimeter bolts to remove the fuel rail. And also there's a couple of plastic grommets here, so you need to wiggle those out. Once you remove those two bolts, you just kind of pull up and wiggle the injectors out of the intake manifold. Might be a little tight. You might want to grab a screwdriver and just pry gently at the same place where those bolts came out. Just pry super gentle. You don't want to bust nothing. Kind of rocking motion, and eventually it should give way. There it goes. I'm being very gentle. Actually, technically, you could probably leave this in together with the intake manifold. I'm just going to remove it to get it out of the way. All right, these fuel injector lines, all you got to do is push down on this metal clip here and then pull up, and they'll come right off. On the bottom side of the fuel rail, there's a vacuum line here, so you got to pull that off, and don't forget to plug it back in. Now would be a good time to inspect and replace any injector O-rings. All right, next we'll pull the PCV, the crankcase ventilation lines. Just kind of walk it off, being really gentle. This one usually comes off by hand. Oh, that was easy. And same thing for the spark plugs. I'll use a bent nose plier and do this. And don't use these points as lever points because they can break off. Next, we'll remove the coil electrical feed here. So there's a red clip, you just slide it to the left, push down, and then pull back. If it's stuck, you can pry ever so gently. This is a 2003 car, so there's a top engine mount bracket here that I'll remove next. The 2004 and newer cars will have a little bit different style motor mount. Now we remove the cam sensor wiring as well. It's the exact same as the coil pack. All right, next we can remove the valve cover. And the valve cover is held on by about 10 or so 8 millimeter bolts. Oh yeah, you'll need a deep drive socket for these because some of these bolts are longer than others. 8 millimeter deep drive. So we've got all 8 bolts off, so I can pry real gentle here. Just pry and it'll come off. There we go. Yeah, chocolate milk on the inside too, yuck. Yeah, the top of the engine is all covered with chocolate milk as well, but otherwise it looks pretty decent. I'm going to spray some brake and parts cleaner to start getting some of that sludge to run back down to the oil pan. As you can see, it comes off pretty easily. So if you just run some sacrificial oil through here with about 2 oil changes, pretty much all of it should end up leaving the car. Right, next we'll take the wheel off so we can get access to the crank pulley. And I'll pull the wheel liner back. The crank pulley's back behind here. Not too bad. It looks like they only managed to break one of the click connectors. All right, we can just fold the wheel liner back out of the way like this. And there's the crank pulley, and this is a 15 millimeter bolt. So we're not going to loosen it, we're just going to use this to rotate the engine to get the cam sprocket to line up to the right spot for the tool we're going to use to lock everything into place. So I've got this fancy chain timing tool kit, which we can use to lock the pulley into place. If you don't have this kit, we can still work around it, but this makes things go a little bit easier. I'll put a link where you can buy one of these. So the main part of the kit is this bracket here, which has a couple of pins that go into some holes on the camshaft sprocket and prevent it from turning. and that lets you go ahead and loosen the camshaft bolt. Unfortunately, the in front of the cutout where the bolt, where the tool needs to go to loosen the camshaft bolt, the cam position sensor is in the way. And to remove the cam position sensor, there's a 10 mil bolt that can only be accessed by removing the engine mount. So that's what we're going to do next. And we'll loosen this with an 18 millimeter socket. We'll get a chunk of wood, put it under here to lift up the engine just a little bit. We just want to raise it just enough that it's not resting on the mount. You may find it easier to jack up if you also loosen the bolts to the lower engine mount. We also need to loosen this ground strap here, 13 millimeter, and put your finger underneath here because there's a bolt that's going to fall out if you don't do that. Next, there's four 16 millimeter bolts here, 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 and here, and then we can take the mount off. All right, now we get the mount out of here. And then we can remove this cam sensor 10 millimeter bolt. And just wiggle the cam sensor on out of there. The tool also comes with a bracket that allows us to take the floor jack out and rest the entire weight of the engine on this bracket. That requires us to remove the engine mount itself. So I'll do that from underneath the car. And this uses an E12 reverse Torx socket. I think if you're in a pinch, you can use a 6.10 mil that'll fit right over it. Okay, now we can locate this bracket right here. Comes with a couple of bolts. It also has a longer bolt that goes in here, but it doesn't thread into anything, and I've never been able to figure out why. So I'll just take an old suspension bolt or something and shove it in there, something long enough that it doesn't move around too much. And now we can lower the engine down onto the bracket. Of course, if you don't have these tools, you can just use the floor jack for the entire job. All right, now we'll grab a 15 millimeter socket, put it on the crankshaft pulley here, and then rotate everything through until those two holes are at the top. And we just rotate this until it's pointing up. There are no timing marks on a Mini. You just kind of rotate until it lines up here like that. If you don't have this tool, you can put the car in like sixth gear and get someone to stand on the brake while you loosen the bolt. But the tool makes it go easier, and it's also a one-man job. This top bolt is going to be an 18 millimeter. I'll use a chunk of breaker bar because it's on there pretty tight. Before we remove the sprocket, we have to loosen the chain tensioner, which is actually on the back of the motor here. It's pretty hard to see. Let's see if I can see it from underneath. It's actually right here behind the oil filter cooler housing. What I do is I put a 6-point socket on it, 6-point 19 millimeter. And you can actually access it from the top. You just can't see what you're doing. It works best on the Cooper S if you've got a wobble extension to get around the cooler housing. Now I'll just put the breaker bar on and when you hear that cracking sound, it means it came loose. And you should be able to loosen it the rest of the way by hand. And here's the chain tensioner. These things do fail, so it might be a good idea to replace this. They cost about 40 bucks or so. This one's full of chocolate milk as well, obviously. Now we can finish loosening the cam sprocket bolt. Take the tool off, and what I'm going to do is make a mark on the sprocket, on the chain, and one of the teeth here. There actually is a BrightLink, but that's usually used for assembly, not disassembly. So basically what we're going to do is leave the crank sprocket attached and leave the chain around it. And we're only going to remove the chain from the camshaft sprocket here. And I'm going to put a little piece of like white out on the chain here, mark it together with one of these sprocket teeth. And then when we reassemble, as long as we got that all lined up, and the crank sprocket, there's a dowel on the camshaft, as long as that's lined up as well, then we're going to be in time when we put everything back together. So you can use some paint or something. I keep some white out in the garage here, and I'm just going to draw a dot here and another one directly across on the sprocket itself. Next, I'll grab a bungee cord, and I'm going to suspend the chain from the hood, from the bonnet latch here. Remove the sprocket. I'll just drop it a little bit so I can work the chain off of the sprocket. I'll put this up and out of the way somewhere, and then I'll use a bungee cord to hold the chain tight. On the back side of the timing cover, there's a little guide, so it should be theoretically impossible for the chain to fall away from the crankshaft sprocket. But just to avoid the chance of that happening, I like to keep it suspended. All right, now we'll work on loosening up the exhaust manifold. So first we'll loosen the heat shield. There's a couple of 13 millimeter bolts here and here. Okay, next, it's going to be really hard to see, but there's a bunch of 10 millimeter bolts. It looks like there's a total of 8 bolts holding the header in place. Okay, and I should just be able to pull and it'll come right off. There we go. Okay, next we'll remove the air box and all this stuff. Kind of pull this and get the battery cable out of the way. Remove the box lid. I'm guessing you'll be able to figure out how to remove most of the airbox stuff over here. So 10 mil right here. Loosen these ECU connections. Oh, and disconnect the negative battery cable before doing this stuff. Kind of pull back on these clamps and it should come out without any force. And just pull up on the back side of the box. It should pop right out of there. I'm going to remove this intake tube as well because it's just blocking access to a bunch of stuff here. Get this out of the way. Unplug the map sensor wire. Unplug the O2 sensor wire. Okay, back here there's a temperature sending unit wire here. You may not be able to see this on your car. It might be at a different rotation angle, but there's a red clip that you can slide backwards. And then you push down on this black bit here on the back, right here, and then you can pull it off. Otherwise you're going to break it, so follow these instructions. Next, we'll remove this thermostat inlet here, but before doing that, we'll drain the radiator. There's no drain plug on the Mini. The only way to drain the coolant is to loosen the bottom radiator hose, which is here on the left side of the car, right behind the AC lines. I use a hose clamp plier, which really helps. If you don't have that, channel lock pliers work pretty good. Just pull and wiggle the clamp off and get the bucket up here to catch all the coolant that's going to come out. You want to loosen the reservoir cap to allow the fluid to all drain out. Otherwise, the vacuum will build. Sometimes it helps to loosen this plug up front as well. There we go. The coolant's pretty clean. It's a little bit dirty from exhaust gas getting into it, but there's no oil in the coolant, and that's pretty common. The water pressure can be higher than the oil pressure at that part of the engine, so typically the water intrudes into the engine block rather than the oil getting into the water, but not always. Okay, now that we've drained the coolant, we can remove the thermostat housing here, which is attached to the side of the block, obviously, or the cylinder head. On the back here as well, there's a 13 millimeter bolt which holds on the heater core hose. So we'll loosen that. We can leave it in place, we just gotta loosen it so that we don't pull it out together with the cylinder head. And obviously, if you haven't done so already, now would be an excellent time to replace your thermostat and your thermostat gasket. Those tend to leak on these cars after around, 100,000 miles. We're gonna wanna remove this guy as well. These are 3 millimeter Allen or hex key. Let's pull that guy up like that. We'll just kind of push that out of the way. Now we'll loosen the 3 10 millimeter bolts. There's one here, here, and there's another one down under. So first we'll remove this bracket. And remember to put this piece back in. It's really easy to forget. You turn that a couple of degrees. Just turn this a couple of degrees to loosen the O2 sensor. So what I like to do is put the bolts together with the bracket. That way it's impossible to forget it. And we'll get the last 10 millimeter bolt, which is down in the middle there. Next, we'll remove these intake bolts, and these are all 13 millimeters. There's 5 of them. The first 5 you can really easily get to with a socket with a universal joint on the end of it. The last one, you want to access it from behind here with just a regular old wrench. You'll probably want to use a magnet pickup tool to avoid dropping the bolt. And for these last two, just use your ratcheting wrench. And you won't be able to pull away the intake manifold just yet. There's a couple of things attached to it. We're not going to remove it from the car. We're just going to pull it back. So we're going to want to remove this 10 millimeter bolt on front here. And the hot side for the intake horn needs to come back as well. So there's 3 11 millimeter bolts here. This last one is very easy to drop. So again, be ready with your pickup tool or stick your finger in there or something. If you angle it down slightly, you can get it out without dropping. Next, we need to remove the throttle body here. 10 millimeter bolts. This will give us enough flex for the intake horn to come backward without having to disconnect it from the intake plastic tube under here. Okay, we should now be able to just wiggle this back enough that it clears. There we go, just barely. Now we'll go get that last intake bolt here. And unfortunately it's too tight that I can't get my ratcheting tool on there. No big deal though. If you loosen it a couple of turns, usually you can loosen the rest of the way just by hand. Okay, that allows us to bring the intake back. But as you can see, it's held on by studs. And I can't back it up all the way, or it actually makes contact with the intake supercharger intercooler horn. So there's just not quite enough clearance here. So what we're going to do is just back it up like this, and then when it's time to lift the cylinder head off, we'll be able to lift the head up and then toward the back of the car a little bit, and that will be just enough to clear the stud here without having to remove the supercharger. Okay, so unless I forgot something, that's all of the things that are attached to the sides of the cylinder head. The last thing we need to do is remove these two plugs. And then there's 10mm bolts in here and here for the chain guides, and we'll pull those out. And these are a size 10mm hex Allen socket or wrench or whatever. So next we'll loosen the 10mm bolts in here, which hold the chain rail in place, or chain guide. And you can pull the chain guide out of the engine. And do the same thing for the back. And that comes on out of there. So now we're getting to the fun part. It's time to remove the rocker arms here and the camshaft. So first thing you want to do is keep track of the orientation. The dowel is on the left here, pointing up. So get your 10mm socket and start loosening the rocker arm bolts from the outside and work your way in. And do this in a couple of passes because some of the springs are going to be under tension from the camshaft lobes pressing on them. So you want to loosen both rocker arms together, working away from the outside to the inside in multiple passes. And typically the intake manifold is the one that's under tension more than the exhaust. All right, now we'll take all the bolts out. Ooh, chocolate milk. Now we can lift the rocker arms up and out. Next, we can remove all these bearing caps. You want to keep track of the orientation and the position of these. They should have a stamp on them telling you what position they are. Right here, it's actually facing backwards. It says 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you want to put them in those, in that order, and remember the direction, although I don't think it's possible to put them on backwards. Usually they come off real easy. These ones, probably because of all the chocolate milk, they've kind of glued themselves down. It's a little more sticky than regular oil. And they're fighting. Just being really careful here. You don't want to damage these because they're machined together with the cylinder head. There you go. And that one came off a lot more easy. Usually they come off basically by hand. There we go. So let's inspect this real quick. That looks pretty good. I don't see too much wear there. This engine has 133,000 miles on it, so that's actually not too bad. The camshaft looks good as well. There's no scoring at all. All right, now we're getting to the fun part. It's time to loosen up all of these cylinder head bolts themselves. And then first we'll do, there's a couple 13mm in front. We'll take those out. And these aren't very tight at all. I think they're like 22 foot-pounds. All right, next is all of the main head bolts. And the head bolts are 15mm. And we'll start from the outside and loosen them a little at a time, going in a reverse star pattern, working from the outside in. I'll just loosen about a quarter turn, And I'll go back again and loosen them the rest of the way now. So that's everything. The head is now loose. Oops, it's leaking water as I do that. So what I'm going to want to do now is lift the head off. I'm going to lift it up and then that way a little bit so the intake manifold will clear. And then after I do that, I'm going to support the chain and lift it the rest of the way off and temporarily disconnect the bungee cord. So first I'm going to go up and just back a little bit. There we go. Now the head is off, as you can see. So I'm going to grab a towel. I'll put a towel here. If you've got a friend to help you, it's super easy. I'm working by myself here. So I'll grab a towel. I'll temporarily rest the head here while I keep tension on the chain. All right, got my towel here. So I'm going to pick up the head. I'm going to temporarily put it right here. And I'll disconnect the bungee cord while holding the chain tight. Then I'll reconnect the bungee cord. All right, the head is now separated from the car. So I think that'll be the end for part one. Come back and watch part two where I finish checking things out, inspecting things, and start putting stuff back together. Thanks for watching, and bye-bye.